Colossians 3, Paul invites the community to be tolerant. And if anyone has a disagreement, you are to forgive, Paul writes. But Paul reminds people that we forgive because God first forgave us. It is a reminder that we are not to boast in our ability to forgive. We are not to show off and tell other people about how good we are at forgiving. Paul reminds us, if we are to boast, let us boast in the Lord, who is the source of all that is good and wonderful and beautiful. Let us begin our time of worship.
Please join with me in our call of worship. Be still before God and listen. There we shall know that we are loved. Sing and shout the good news. And in doing so, we are telling others how they are loved. Whether we are listening or speaking, stepping back or actively serving, the message is the same.
We are loved beyond measure.
Thanks be to God. Please stand as you are able and join with us in our singing our opening hymn. Please join with me in prayer. O God, whose foolishness is wiser than our wisdom, draw us to yourself. Use whatever tools necessary to communicate to these often hardened hearts the good news of your redemptive love. We delight this day in the work of your grace that teaches us how to show mercy and to live kindness. Yet such gifts need to be first felt within our own spirits. Let us once again hear your glorious news made real in Jesus Christ, that we are loved members of your family. We pray these words in the name of the one who lived a life of welcome and affirmation. Amen.
Lord,
gathered together in this worship service, and we have the opportunity to worship in spirit and in truth. It's good to see each and every one of you here this morning, especially those of you who are visiting with us. I'd like to draw your attention to that little blue card that's always in your order of service. This is a wonderful means by which you can communicate new information that our church needs to know, or to communicate prayer concerns or any other thing that you'd like to tell us. Bring those with you when we come forward for our communion and offering time and place them in the offering plates. Visitors, also, we hope that you'll stop by the visitor's desk in the Northrex, because we have a very special gift for you. But most importantly right now, let's give one another, especially our visitors, a warm Cypress Creek welcome.
Good morning. It is good to be with you on this first day of the week. Society says that Monday kicks off the week, but for us, it is Sunday. It is the Lord's Day, and it's what prepares us for the days that follow. So I am glad that you have chosen to be here this morning. I do want to just reinforce those blue cards that Mark mentioned earlier. Please bring them forward, not only letting us know you were here, but letting us know how we can pray for you. Unless you're thinking about joining, and then we all say, keep a hold of it, and you can give it to one of the elders, you can give it to me at the close of the service. Some other things I want to lift up. First of all, we will continue with our Wednesday studies, both noon and at 6:30. We are continuing to look at Paul's writings to the church at Corinth. It's what I've been preaching on the last two Sundays, and again today, but I hope you'll come and join us. Looking forward to Saturday and the work that we are going to be doing together, the SOAP ministry. Teresa Flores is bringing her program. It is saving our adolescents from prostitution. We are going to have somewhere in the neighborhood of 15,000 to 20,000 bars of soap that we are going to be wrapping with information about the National Human Trafficking Hotline. We will be then taking them out to the community after lunch and dropping them off at hotels as we approach a big football game that is coming to town. It is a time in which there is usually an increase in human trafficking in the host city. So I hope that you will come and participate. There's an opportunity to sign up today. Again, there will be lunch, and so we're kind of wanting to know how many people to expect for lunch. But it will be a great way of coming together as community and doing something that will impact the larger community and our nation, and ultimately, I believe, our world. Every Sunday is a wonderful Sunday, but next Sunday is Laity Sunday, a marvelous time, and next week it will be our Stephen Ministry program that is going to be bringing worship to us. So I hope you'll come and be a part of that. And then looking ahead, February 17th and 18th, that's a Friday and Saturday, is the area men's retreat out at Camp Gonzo. For any men that would be interested in attending, there is information out at the kiosk. You can find it in the church office. But on that Saturday, the 18th, is also a women's retreat right here at Cypress Creek. And there is also information about that. So I hope that you will consider participating in those wonderful opportunities. It is good sometimes to step away and to pause and to breathe and to be together as community in settings like that. Again, for the last 2 weeks, and then today, the third week, we are looking at the very first chapter of 1 Corinthians. The idea was to draw upon some themes that we would see throughout these letters, both 1 and 2 Corinthians, and to emphasize them. Again, you can follow up for the next 4 weeks or so. I will be focused on those two letters in my daily blog, or you can come to our Wednesday study and be a part of the conversation there. But hear now these words, starting with verse 26. Look at your situation when you were called, brothers and sisters. By ordinary human standards, not many of you were wise. Not many of you were powerful. Not many of you were from the upper class. But God chose what the world considers foolish to shame the wise. God chose what the world considers weak to shame the strong. And God chose what the world considers low class and low life, what is considered to be nothing, to reduce what is considered to be something to nothing, so that no human being can brag or boast in God's presence. It is because of God that you are in Christ Jesus. He became wisdom from God for us. This means that he made us righteous and holy, and he has delivered us. This is consistent with what is written, "The one who brags shall brag in the Lord." These are the words of God. With open hearts and open minds, we pray that we are able to receive the magnificent and holy message they deliver. Let us pray. We gather to brag, not on ourselves, but on you, Lord God, to give honor to you, to give thanks to you, and to seek wisdom from you, wisdom for the living of life. Wisdom that comes from letters that Paul wrote, from your spirit, and from the community of faith. Bless our time. In the name of Christ, amen. My grandmother had many phrases that she would pull out and share. Very familiar phrases like, he's getting a bit too big for his britches. I heard that one on more than one occasion directed back at me, and I don't believe she was talking about my waistline when she said it. Or she might say, he needs to be brought down a peg or two. Both of those communicated very similar points. Both suggested that an individual's current status was not what it should be. On occasion, our egos need to be emptied. Our uppityness needs a little groundedness. Our self-absorption needs some gentle self-abasement. Scripture, on more than one occasion, speaks about the arrogant and the haughty, those who are smug and feeling a bit pompous. It speaks about how they are not to keep their high and mighty status for long. Jeremiah the prophet wrote, "O arrogant ones, the Lord is against you. Your time is over." Mary, the mother of Jesus, sang a song, and in those words she said, "God has scattered the self-centered and brought down the powerful." And even Jesus taught that the first shall be last. The stories of faith are often described as good news. But good news for who? Hearing the words of Jeremiah, hearing the song of Mary, the mother of Jesus, hearing the teachings of Jesus, it makes you wonder, is it good news for everyone? Well, to the surprise of some of you, I am going to suggest this morning that yes, it is good news for everyone. For a few weeks now, we have been looking at Paul's writings to the church at Corinth. In my daily blog, in our Wednesday studies, been exploring this. And though we only have part of a conversation, half of it from Paul's perspective, and that half is somewhere in the neighborhood of 1,960 some years old now, we still are able to glean from these words what it was that was behind the writing, what it was that triggered Paul to send this letter from probably where he was in Ephesus to the church at Corinth. It's because news had gotten to Paul about a conflict in the community. People were boasting. They were boasting about themselves. They were getting a bit too arrogant. And such attitudes were destructive to the community. I love those lines that I read to you just moments ago. Look at your situation when you were called, brothers and sisters. By ordinary human standards, not many of you were wise. Not many of you were powerful. Not many of you came from the upper echelon of society. I've got to think the first readers of Paul's letter here would not have heard those words as a compliment. Basically, Paul is kind of saying to them, you all are not the brightest folks in the world. Not all that impressive, actually. And frankly, you're not very good looking. The people have got to be thinking to themselves, ouch, this kind of hurts. Where's he going with this? But, Paul writes, and that is an important conjunction to note, but God chose what the world considers foolish to shame the wise. God chose what the world considers weak to shame the strong. And God chose what the world considers low class and low life, what is considered by the world to be nothing, to reduce what is considered to be something to nothing. God did this so that no human being can brag in the presence of God. Paul is making an important distinction between the world's perspective and God's perspective. What the world considers weak and low class and low life, what the world has considered to be nothing at all, is the very thing that God used, because the world's opinion doesn't appear to carry much weight in the mind of God. And God used such people, bottom rung kind of people, the low class and the low lives, at least according to the world's perspective, to turn the world on its head. There are egos that need to be emptied. There is some uppityness that needs some groundedness. There are those who are self-absorbed who need some gentle self-abasement. God brings them down not just for the sake of bringing them down. God knocks folks off of what my grandmother would call their high horse, not just because it makes God feel good. It's because the kingdom of God is not built with the attitudes of the arrogant. It is not built with the hands of the haughty. It is not built with the contributions of the conceited. God wants to bring folks down so that they can participate with God in the building of the kingdom of God from the ground up. Paul had seen the destructive power of the arrogant and the haughty and the conceited. That kind of power on the structure and framework, the values and the convictions of the church at Corinth. But even those who were arrogant and haughty and conceited were not written off by God, not at all. They just needed to be brought down a peg or two or maybe three. Paul is speaking to those people, but he's also looking at another group of folks. Those who for much of their lives had felt worthless and weak, had felt the sting of the world's judgment because the world considered them to be low class and low life, a nothing in this world. But what God says in Paul's writings, in this mixed up, nonsensical order of the kingdom of God, you are in fact exactly what I need. You are going to help to build this kingdom. In fact, you are going to be an essential component in the building of that kingdom. Tony Campolo is one of my favorite people. Now a retired professor, he is still going out and preaching the gospel. His son Bart, when Bart was a very young boy, had a yellow blanket. It was the best thing in the world in Bart's mind. He carried it everywhere he went. It was a source of comfort. It provided him a sense of strength. It calmed him when he was upset. It went everywhere, and when it went missing, Mom and Dad stopped everything and went and found the yellow blanket. But after 3 years, it was no longer the beautiful yellow blanket it once was. It was a torn, stained yellow rag. But for Bart, it was still everything. It still had value and beauty. Had someone found it, there's no way they would argue that it had value. If they didn't know Bart, they would have just tossed it on the trash heap. But it had value because of what Bart saw in it. And not only did it have value for Bart, it had value for Bart's family because of the way Bart saw it. You may feel like a torn up rag. Some people may look at you and think that you belong on the trash heap. But there is one who believes that in fact you are of value, that there is purpose and virtue that is within you. But we do not boast in ourselves. We boast in the one who is not only the means by which we discover that truth, but is the one who continues to speak to us and invite us to use that value for the purpose of building the kingdom. And so whether you are one that feels as if society has thrown you upon the trash heap, or whether you are one that recently fell from some perceived place of superiority and surprisingly find yourself on that heap, the good news for everyone is that there is someone else who stands in that place defined by the world as nothingness and declares, this is where the kingdom of God is being built, and these are the people who will build that kingdom. You may think of yourself as lost. You may see yourself as one who has been discarded to that place of the low class and the low lives, where everyone appears to be a no one, but God beat you there and has redefined it as a place where kingdom builders are found. The author John Maxwell writes, "Don't think less of yourself. Just think of yourself less. And know that God thinks of you often, and in fact thinks the world of you. And ultimately, that is all that matters. Whether you feel as if you have spent your life as a no one, or whether you recently found yourself knocked off of some vantage point of arrogance, no matter how you find yourself down, know that it is not a place where you need to give up. It is the place where God is already moving. And if by chance you are sitting currently all high and mighty, feeling pretty smug, and have gotten a little too big for your britches, be confident that God will find someone or something that will bring you down a peg or two. And it's not because God is mean or God doesn't like you. It's because God wants all of us to participate in the building of God's kingdom. And it starts from the ground up, not from the top down. Whatever has brought you to the place that you are, hear again Paul's words. God uses what the world has called nothing to do something. Something important, something significant, something extraordinary, something awesome. But when God uses you, don't let it go to your head and make sure you still fit in your pants. Don't build yourself up, but don't count yourself out. Don't brag about your abilities, but don't underestimate those abilities. Don't pat yourself on the back, but realize that God has already placed a hand upon your back and is guiding you to that place where you can be the most useful in building the kingdom of God. Will you pray with me? Lord God, let our boasting be not in our own accomplishments, not in worldly success, not because of the pats we get on the back or the number of times our name is praised by others. Let us boast, Lord, in you and in the generosity of your love and the never-ending gift of your forgiveness and the far-reaching capacity of your redemptive grace. Let us boast in what is worthy of that honor. Let us boast in you. For those who have lifted themselves up a bit too high, for those who have expanded beyond the measurements of their pants, you seek to bring them down, to empty them of ego. For those who have been devalued and dismissed, you seek to provide them your value and to dismiss the powers that seek to usurp the power of your opinion. You have a dream. A dream for all of creation. You have a dream for each one of us, and it probably has very little to do with worldly accomplishments and everything to do with kingdom accomplishments. Accomplishments that ultimately are from you. Gracious God, we have stepped out of the world and into this place this morning. Yet our minds are never too far from what happens out in the world. Our nation has seen another peaceful transition of power. For some, it has been a week of celebration. For others, it has been a difficult week. For whatever our perspective, we pray for discernment and wisdom for every person who finds him or herself in leadership. May they hear from you and not just from those who want something from them. May they serve you by becoming a servant to all. May they work not only for the people who have, but on behalf of those who have not. And Lord, make your church a place where the humble and the formerly haughty are about the work of building your kingdom of love, your kingdom of grace, your kingdom of mercy, where all are welcome. This morning I am mindful, Lord, of those right here in the life of our own community who feel as if they have been knocked down. Some who are feeling pain physically, emotionally, even those who wonder if they have fallen outside of your care. For each of them, we pray that your glorious news of love, of a love that is so powerful that there is no place that it cannot go, may that news touch their hearts this day. And today we lift up Vern, Bob, Angie, Peggy, Elta Lee, Jerry, Cameron. We lift them before you, God, knowing that you are the one who has already come down among us and has whispered your words of grace to them. We are a thankful people, offering these words in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Most of us know the name Saint Francis. We know this man of simple ways, a man of great humility. Many of us look up to someone like that. But he was not a person of power in his time. It's interesting how many of us could name the kings and the princes at that time. How many of us could name who the Pope was or the bishops were? Most of us do not know their names, but we know the name of the one who chose to empty himself and to serve others in a very simple way. Even while he was alive, people tried to lift him up, but he was quick in his writings to point elsewhere, to point to God. Today, in our gardens, we do not have statues to the popes or the kings or the princes of that time. We have maybe a statue of Saint Francis. But I even believe if Francis was to show up, he would be embarrassed and invite us to maybe replace that with something that reminded us about Jesus. Every week when we come to the table, we do so with stuff that we are still working on. You don't have to have it all figured out and sorted out before you feel welcome. God wants you to bring it all, because something powerful can happen in the sharing of the bread and the cup. Not that at the end of this meal we'll have it all figured out, but it is a process in which we begin to understand better who God has called us to be. And it's not usually in an upward movement, it is usually a calling downward, that we might be people who truly serve one another, serving the world on behalf of the living Christ, in the bread that is broken, in the cup that is shared. Let us better learn the ways of Jesus. Let us prepare now for a time at the table.
The invitation to this table is as extensive and inclusive as is the love of God. So all are invited and all are welcome at this, the Lord's table. At Cypress Creek, we observe communion every Sunday. We take communion by intention, dipping the bread into the cup. And in doing so, we open our minds and hearts to the spiritual presence of God in our midst and within each and every one of us. As we come forward, we bring our blue cards and offerings as well as additional acts of worship. If you're not able to come forward in just a moment, please raise your hand and the elements will be brought to you. Now let's join together in prayer.
Our Father, help us to find in this simple loaf and this cup those things which help us remember the risen Lord. Now, as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, give us the courage and strength to allow your Spirit to work through us, no matter if the world sees us as great or small. Bind us together in fellowship with all who seek to follow you. Amen.
The scriptures declare that on the night which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread in the company of his disciples. He broke it, and having blessed it, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, he took the cup, and having blessed it, he distributed it to his disciples, saying, "Drink of this. This is my blood, my life, the life of the new covenant. As often as you do it, do this in remembrance of me." And so we come in remembrance, taking deeply into our hearts and into our minds all that Jesus has done and all that God has done through him for us today.
Faithful Father, no matter how small and meek we may feel, remind us that all things are great and all things are mighty when they're works of our Jesus. Bless these gifts we bring in your blessed and holy name. Amen.
A community has come together for worship. We have started our week by being together, by praying together and singing together and hearing scripture. And my prayer is that we are better prepared for the week that lies ahead. The world will be inviting us to step our way up, not caring about who we step on. But Jesus invites us to take a step back and to kneel and to serve and to show compassion and concern. It is a challenge, but if we choose to accept the challenge, the world will be blessed, the world will be changed. Here at Cypress Creek Christian Church, every Sunday, we extend an invitation into this community of faith, but most importantly, into a life with the living Christ. If you wish to respond to that invitation, you can either come forward as we sing, or you can meet with one of our elders or pastors at the close of the service. Let us now join our voice in a hymn that, listen to the words and listen to what you are requesting in this hymn. Think I can sing the words from memory because I just sang, fill me of my spirit instead of thy spirit. There is part of the problem about our egos, relinquishing and making room for God's spirit to dwell. You often see a lot of activity at certain times of the year right up here. We're trying to dodge the sunlight that is coming in. And it is bad enough sometimes that you can't even see the screen when it is shining in your face. So we're not Pentecostal up here, but even if we were, that'd be okay. I do want to remind you about next Saturday and that important ministry, SOAP, that we're going to be participating in. And then I invite you just to keep our youth who have been out at Camp Gonzo this weekend for their midwinter retreat. They've been out there, or actually probably driving back right now, and we look forward to having them back and hearing about their experiences together with youth from all over the area. I invite you now to reach out to someone, take hands, let us be bound together, and let us share together in the prayer seen on the screen. Gracious God, may your love and our lives come together in a life lived in love. May Jesus be our mentor and our model, and may the world see in us
love
that is willing to put love first in all things. Amen.